Our next speaker this morning is managing director at Goldman Sachs and lead architect of the recently open source project Legend, is Pierre de Belen. In addition, he co-manages Goldman's data platform team, which is responsible for developing data-centric and user-focused solutions to power the firm's data strategy. Today, he joins us to share details about open sourcing Legend, the flagship of Goldman Sachs data strategy, and maybe now yours. Please welcome Pierre de Belen.
Hello, my name is Pierre de Belen, and I manage the Data Model Engineering Department at Goldman Sachs. We just completed the first phase of open sourcing the Legend platform by contributing its code to the Finos Foundation. I'd like to thank the whole Finos team for their help and their support throughout this journey. Today, I'm going to give a high-level overview of our platform and describe several of its use cases. Some can be implemented with the code currently available on our GitLab projects, while others may require code that will be available in upcoming contributions. As you may know, the problem of data management in finance are less related to the volume of data processing than they are related to the fragmentation of our data and the incredible amount of actors participating in the finance processing flow, creating communication issues, processing breaks, and other inefficiencies. Legend is the data management platform that provides solutions to these problems by focusing on data discovery, helping technical and non-technical users to find data, data transformation, linking information together and building a leverageable lineage graph, data quality, improving quality checks all along the processing pipelines, and data delivery, making it possible for all actors to easily and safely acquire data. However, it is sometimes better to define something by what it is not than by what it is. In this respect, Legend is not a data analytics platform. It does integrate with existing analytics environments like Python and R, and also business intelligence tools like Tableau and ClickView. It is meant to help users organize and transform their data so that it can be easily and safely delivered to these platforms. What does safely mean? It means that users will have more confidence that the data they are retrieving is what they expected. This is thanks to the transparent lineage. That the quality is appropriate. This is thanks to the centralized and collaborative definition of constraints enforced as early as possible in the transformation flow. That users only see what they are authorized to see, respecting data sensitivity and privacy. All these functions are made possible by effectively managing metadata. We ensure that the metadata is always up to date and accurate because it's driving the execution flows. So let's look at the tools that constitute the platform. The platform relies on two servers, the SDLC server and the engine server. Both of them can be seen at the bottom of the diagram. Let's look at them in more detail. First, the SDLC server. It currently provides a driver to the GitLab product, which manages the lifecycle of our metadata. SDLC is key to our platform, as most of our metadata ends up being leveraged in production flow. Having the proper level of audit and review is critical to operating our environments and also to meet the requirements of our auditors and regulators. The platform also relies on the engine server that provides functions like grammar parsing. It converts the pure language into an abstract syntax tree that are returned as JSON structure. The pure language is a legend modeling language. It is used to describe structural models but it is also describing queries, constraints, checkoff transforms within the mapping DSLs, and data derivations. The engine also provides a compilation API that provides feedback about errors that could have been made during code writing. Another important engine feature is also to provide query execution, leveraging three important inputs. First, a function representing the query, then a mapping that maps types expressed in the query to elements of a data source, and finally, a runtime that provides a way to connect to a data source. We will cover this use case in a little bit more details later in the presentation. Finally, the engine provides APIs for model transformation. Example would be generating from a model a JSON schema or Java code. JSON schemas can be leveraged to validate serialization or to define contracts in data servicing using Swagger or OpenAPI, for example. The two servers enable several client applications that help users during their journey working with data. First, a kube environment that provides simple relational-like queries with operations such as filter, join, or group by. It is mainly used to investigate new data that we could acquire from vendors or by looking at legacy databases. When investigations are done and users decide to invest in the data, then they graduate to Studio. Studio allows them to build models that document the semantic of the data and mapping that binds modeled information to data source. This provides APIs that can be leveraged by a large number of users and that can be maintained for a long time period. Once the models and mappings to data sources are created in Studio, users can leverage the query tool to easily access data. They don't have to remember any localized knowledge required to join a trade to a product that they would have using Kube. They can also write any graph query they can imagine without being blocked by a static service layer. And finally, if users want to leverage their query programmatically, they can publish it to the service tool. It pre-calculates the necessary query plans and enables self-service operational support. Now that you're familiar with the Legend and its components, let's go over some use cases. Let's start with the derivatives use case. It was one of the main motivations behind the open sourcing of our platform. The derivative flow is complex because derivative contracts evolve frequently, have deeply complex tangled structures, are processed by many different parties within each firm and also outside each firm, which means that derivative contracts are leveraging different schemas and thus require transformations. They are built with different technologies, as many of these processing steps were built at different times and also require different query engine capabilities. They require many validations to encode all the knowledge and requirements of all actors. To illustrate these facts and looking at the diagram, booking and quote require simple data entry schemas. These schemas need to be available for service technologies so that, for example, they can be easily externally available to clients. Thus, the model needs to be transformed to API language like Swagger or OpenAPI. Price and risk need to interface with calculators that may require a deeper integration than services in order to perform calculation optimization. Clearing will require interfacing with external standards like FPML or CDM. Reg reporting schemas are optimized to report information across assets and thus are represented in a really different way than the original contract structure. How does Legend improve these flows? First, by letting users express models that can be converted to different technologies in a central environment. By defining mappings between the different models. By letting any users define constraints that can be enforced anywhere in the flow. For example, Back office can define constraints enforced at booking time. And by finally operating all these models and transforms in a strong SDLC to optimize communication among the different teams and to accelerate the potential modifications and improvement of financial terms. The current open source code can operate this use case. However, as I'm speaking, we still have to contribute transformations like pure to Rosetta or pure to JSON schema, and also the integration with the GitLab build pipeline so that the creation of artifacts and the execution of tests can be done automatically. Both will come shortly in the next weeks. Another use case heavily used in our environment is a self-service data access use case. Once a model and a mapping to a data source have been defined in Studio, users can leverage the query tool to easily access information. People often ask me, why is it easier to formulate a query using models than it is using the data source directly? First, data sources have many different query languages. It may be hard to train all your users to know them all, especially business users that may not have the time or the interest to do so. Second, the model provides safeguards during query creation and makes data access simple. It also helps users not to waste time on things that are not necessary during query creation. For example, how to technically navigate from a position to an account, especially if they are stored in different systems, or the navigation requires a complex join expression. Let me illustrate that with an example. Let's look at product and synonyms. It looks like a pretty simple example that is an important building block in the finance data space. Let's look at their database representation, focusing on information that define their relationship. A product will have many synonyms, and that's why the synonym table contains the product IDI key. As we can already see, the information is encoded in a technical way and can already frighten non-technical users. This is usually because databases use historical convention, mostly understood and managed by DBAs. Let's go through the process of modeling the tables to remove ambiguity about data access. So the first thing to do is to create the concepts we are interested in, so we can create product and synonym. We can already see that the properties are clearer to users. We represent the relationship between product and synonyms as a property named synonyms. This is already interesting, as joining two tables is never as simple as joining a primary key to a foreign key. There's always something else to think about. So we provide these models to users and we let them query. The first feedback is that they want to easily and quickly get one specific synonym using the model. So we can modify the model and add a qualifier. It makes it clear that you can get one synonym out of the related synonym set given a synonym type. So the models start to carry more information than the initial tables. So we give it to our users, and they come back saying that the model is broken and that they had multiple products come in when they filtered products for a specific synonym. This is because not all synonyms are global. They do have different scopes. Some are valid for a market, some for a region, and some are global. So we improve the model. I illustrate only for global and market synonym, but the same principle scales for different scopes. Now, users are protected by the API and understand that in order to access a market synonym without any ambiguity, they will also need to provide a financial market. The model comes with far more depth and documentation than just the raw tables and is more suited to ease self-service as it has built-in answers to usual questions. Now that we have a model, users can easily access information by walking the graph and define a tree that univocally qualified the information. We can see that something called simply price in a grid can be fully qualified as the stop price of the last order version, for example, which avoids miscommunications and error. This is exactly what the query tool enables users to do. This use case requires the model to database mapping capability that will be available by Q1 2021 and the query tool that will be made available by Q4 2021. Thank you so much for your attention. If you want more information, you can find some on our microsite at legend.finos.org, and please don't hesitate to check out our code on our GitHub repositories.